Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'm Duncan Brown from the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, and welcome to this, our seventh session in the ninth year of our Rethinking Seminar Series. The series this year is sponsored by the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab. Our theme this year is Rethinking U.S. National Security Imperatives in a Time of Transition. This naturally includes examining transitions in budgets, threats, potential adversaries, and geostrategic politics. Before introducing tonight's speaker, a few quick announcements. First, we do tape all of our seminars, and as such, we also provide bulletized notes and any presentations that the speakers provide. The easiest way to find our website is by simply typing in three words into Google, Rethinking Johns Hopkins and Seminar. The other thing is we also have a YouTube channel now, and you can find a lot of the videos on that YouTube channel as well as also on our website. The second announcement is that in order to properly videotape these events, we do use wireless microphones, and unfortunately anything you have that's electronic that either transmits or receives, whether it be a BlackBerry or a cell phone or an iPad, does directly interfere with the wireless microphones, and so I would ask that at this time you turn those things off. Our third announcement is that our next speaker will be Dr. Stephen Brooks from Dartmouth College, and he will be here on April 18th to discuss his recent international security article on the pros and cons of a U.S. posture of forward presence and global engagement. So he's going to talk about the pros and cons of that, and he'll offer his opinions. And now for tonight's speaker. Ms. Robin Wright is a renowned journalist, author, and foreign policy analyst, who is currently serving at the U.S. Institute for Peace as a senior fellow and the Wilson Center Distinguished Scholar. Ms. Wright has reported from more than 140 countries on six continents for the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, the Sunday Times of London, CBS News, and the Christian Science Monitor. She is also an award-winning contributor to many magazines and journals. In addition to her career in journalism, she has worked for several prestigious think tanks, including the Brookings Institution and the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Tonight, I have asked Ms. Wright to discuss the Arab Spring, where it has been, where it is now, the rise of political Islam, the counter-jihad that is arising against extremism, and what to expect over the coming years. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Ms. Robin Wright.
Thank you very much. I'm honored that on a day of such foul weather and a night that's also the beginning of Passover that anyone showed up. Thank you for the introduction, Duncan. A Pollyanna I am not, as you'll discover as I talk. But I want to applaud you for rethinking anything, which I think doesn't happen enough in Washington. And the whole idea that you're spending a whole season looking at national security really makes me feel good about the potential of something actually coming out of Washington. I think we, in the 13th year of the 21st century, tend still to be locked into 20th century models and understanding of the world, and that we're not looking ahead enough. So bravo to and bravo to all of you. I first landed in the Middle East on October 6, 1973, which was the day the Fourth Middle East War erupted. I've since covered all six wars, as well as every revolution, uprising, and most of the major terrorism attacks in the region. I lived in Beirut from 1980 to 1985 during the Israeli invasion, the Lebanese Civil War. I can still hear the bomb go off at the Marine Barracks in 1983. Which was the largest loss of U.S. military life in a single incident since Iwo Jima, still to this day. I knew the early founders of Hezbollah. I saw the PLO during its heydays of extremist or terrorism. And I also knew Yasser Arafat when he signed the peace accord with Israel, and then used to see him on visits with the Secretary of State. I think what is happening in the Middle East today is the most dynamic an important story of the early 21st century. It's an extraordinary turning point. It's, I think, one of the four most important events in the region in the last century. It's reshaping what's happening in the same way that the first turning point did, and that was the collapse of the Ottoman Empire after World War I and the creation of the modern states, modern Arab states. And secondly, after World War II, the creation of Israel, which redefined conflict and security. And the third, of course, was the 1979 revolution, which introduced Islam as an idiom not only of opposition, but as modern governance. And we often don't appreciate how seismic that was in the Islamic world, in which the clerics had not ruled a state in 14 centuries since the faith was founded in the 7th century. And the fourth, of course, is the Arab uprisings, a really epic convulsion, which I think is actually, and you'll understand that I think like you guys do, I love numbers. And so I think in numbers of everything. And for me, it's all equations. And I throw in a new variable, and then the equation comes out differently. So I think it's one of it's on a par with change in three other parts of the world. First was the demise of communism in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. It's on a par with the collapse of military dictatorships in Latin America and the end of apartheid and minority rule in Africa. I covered all of those events, and to me, what's happening in the Arab world is part and parcel of the same phenomena. It's this moment in history where we're beginning to see the emergence of a common set of values and aspirations. They're reflected in some ways in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that was put out with an important role by Eleanor Roosevelt after the creation of the United Nations, but was never really enforced. And it's been extraordinary to see how the peoples in each of those regions took the initiative themselves. This was not top-down change. This was really bottom-up that put pressure on the leadership to accept what had become inevitable. So the changes that we see play out on two different levels inside the region. The first is the one we all recognize, which is the challenge to autocrats. It's astounding to think that in the last 2 years, we've seen the demise of the leaders of Egypt, Tunisia, Yemen, and Libya, who together, just four men, ruled a total of 129 years. Almost unbelievable. But it's also important because of, for all of us living in the United States who remember the 9/11, it's also important because it is a moment at which the majority of people in the region, not all, but the majority, tens of millions of people have turned out on the streets with a message that they reject extremism as the means of creating change. In each of these countries, the uprisings began in the world's most volatile region through peaceful civil disobedience. Now, it deteriorated in Libya and eventually in Syria. But in Syria, what's so striking is it took months to get to the point that people took up arms. To me, this is the most interesting place of change, not just because it's the strategic center of the region, but because it was also the most brutal and brittle regime. I lived in Beirut during the Assad dynasty's attack on Hama in 1982, when the uprising against Damascus led to a crackdown that in a mere 3 weeks killed up to 25,000 people. Today we see the way that it has played out in people resisting in a way they never have before, putting their lives on the line. It's really quite extraordinary. There's a new kind of martyrdom in the region. And one of the most moving stories to me is how it all started when a young fruit vendor in a remote Tunisian town was approached by a government inspector who demanded a $7 bribe. The inspector had demanded the same bribe over and over and over. And the fruit vendor, whose name was Mohamed Bouazizi, had always paid it. But it was also more than he made in any given day, selling oranges and lemons and figs and dates on a street corner off a wooden cart in a poor rural city. And so for the first time, he said no. And so the inspector mobilized some police, and they confiscated all of his produce, and then his $100 electronic scale. And this was a young man who supported five siblings, his mother, and an ailing uncle. And he decided he'd had enough. And so he went from government office to government office to try to get his fruit back. All he wanted was a job. He wasn't looking to vote for a liberal, democratic, secular party. He just wanted a job to support his family. And when he was rebuffed at every office, he then went to the street corner in front of the governor's house and poured his body with paint thinner and set himself on fire. And what was so striking about this, and it was a turning point for Islam as much as for autocratic rule, is that his goal was not to kill foreigners or Western government or non-Muslim targets. It was to shame his government. It took him 3 weeks to die, but within 30 days, President Ben Ali, who had been in power for 23 years, was forced to flee the country. In 30 days, he managed to do what Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda had been trying to do across the region for a couple of decades. This is a whole different kind of martyrdom, and we're seeing this now play out across the region. There's a young Syrian boy, age 13. He's become the icon of the Syrian uprising. His name is Hamza al-Khatib. And Hamza came from the rural Syrian town where its uprising began. When 13 and 14-year-olds got up and spray-painted graffiti on government buildings. And when they were arrested, their friends and families turned out to protest their arrest and demand their release. And when the government refused, that launched the protests. Well, a couple of months later, Hamza was with his parents on the street protesting, and they were separated. And his parents were frantic, and they went to police stations and hospitals, then to jails, asking everywhere if they'd seen their 13-year-old son. 30 days later, Hamza's body was returned to his parents. It was covered with cigarette burns. There were 3 gunshots, and at the age of 13, his genitals had been cut off. And the government's message was to parents everywhere, if you do this, if you get out and protest against us, you endanger the lives of your children, no matter how young they are. And the striking thing, it hadn't turned to an armed conflict at that point, was the fact that Syrians were not intimidated, even after the government put pictures of Hamza's body on television. Syrians turned out instead in ever greater numbers. Now, you will see a lot of terrible pictures on television and read haunting analyses these days in the newspaper about the state of play everywhere. But I want to stand back and take, because you're in the process of rethinking, and look at some basics. Why there is not just political change, but a culture of change that no matter what happens, will really have a far greater influence in determining what's next, what comes a decade or two decades from now. And I begin with three basic factors. One, for the first time in the region, you have the majority of the populations across the region well under 30 years old. It is proportionately the largest baby boom anywhere in the world. The average age in Syria is 22. The average age in Saudi Arabia is 26. In Yemen, it's around 18. The second and related factor is that for the first time, the majority of people in the region, particularly the young, are literate. They may not have high school degrees or college educations, but they can read and write. They have a sense of what is happening beyond their neighborhood, beyond their city, their town, their province, their country. They've seen what's happened elsewhere in the world over the last 30 or 40 years. They get it, and they want very much to be a part of it. And the third and also related factor are the tools of technology that give them access to the outside world, both in receiving messages about values and change, but also in putting out their message. But it's not just Twitter and the internet and YouTube and Facebook that have changed things. Although, at the height of the Egyptian uprising, Facebook was so popular that a young couple who gave birth to a daughter during the three-week uprising against Hosni Mubarak decided to name their daughter Facebook. It's also the fact that we're now almost a generation into what I call the Al Jazeera effect. In the mid-1990s, Al Jazeera became the first independent television station in the region to be region-wide, to go beyond the control of the government in talking about what was really happening in other countries, and in a familiar language. CNN was in English, not always available. Al Jazeera was available. But what's happened since then is astounding. Today, there are over 500 independent satellite stations in Arabic in the Middle East. And what that's done, because there are different clerics on different channels, different talk shows, different news commentaries, different soap operas, different entertainment shows, including Arabs Got Talent, is that a whole generation has been brought up to understand diversity. There is no longer one truth, one idea, one path. This generation has a much wider view. I can have my own opinion, and I can do something about that opinion, and I can speak out about it, and I can reach out to the media and have my voice heard. So you have these three factors that are not going to change over the next couple of decades. These are basics. Now, when we look at what's happening in the region, this culture of change plays out in ways that we don't always see reflected in the daily news. So I want to tell you about five aspects of the culture of change, things that you might not think about. The first is what I call hip-hop Islam. Rap has literally become the rhythm of resistance across the Arab world. Several weeks before the young fruit vendor set himself on fire, a young Tunisian rapper, 21 years old, put on his Facebook page a song he'd written. He recorded, a friend videotaped, his face always in the shadow. The lyrics were tougher against the regime than any politician in Tunisia had ever been. They talked about people living off garbage, the corruption among the police, condemning the president for living in a bubble and not understanding his people, not having any real contact with them. This song took off across Facebook. It was picked up region-wide. And one of the most interesting things to happen after Mohamed Bouazizi set himself on fire, and people in Tunisia began to take to the streets as they began to sing the young rapper's song. And it was sung in protests for the whole month. And then it spread to Egypt and Bahrain and beyond. And today across the Middle East, you find rap groups that are changing the way of providing a message. In the Palestinian territory, well, in among the Palestinians, they actually live in Israel, are three young Palestinians. They formed a group called DAM, D-A-M, and there are two brothers and a friend. And they are angry, like all Palestinians, that they don't have their state. But they're offering the young a different means of transmitting their message, an alternative to suicide vests and Molotov cocktails and rockets. Their lyrics are angry, but they've actually found such a following that they've communicated with Israeli rappers, and that led them to perform together and then to perform in Israeli clubs. That's something really different. In Egypt, there are dozens of groups now that perform. Again, rap is the idiom of opposition. In Iran, in the 2009 presidential election, rap was a very popular means of communicating opposition reform messages, the pro-democracy message of the two leading opposition candidates, one of whom was a 70-year-old cleric who had CDs cut in a country where, after the revolution, music was banned altogether, any kind of music, as West toxication, the poisoning by the West. And the 70-year-old cleric had over 10,000 CDs produced with pro-democracy messages, all in rap. It's something that's attracted the young. It inspires them. And you find it in their talent contests and in their political messages. There's not a country, including Saudi Arabia, that doesn't have rappers challenging not only autocratic governments, but also extremist movements. Again, that dual message, we reject both extremes, and that's tremendously important for us. The second cultural trend are the new Muslim superheroes in the Middle East. My favorite among them, something called the 99. They are comic book superheroes. They were developed by a Kuwaiti psychologist who had five sons and wanted to give them alternative role models to Osama bin Laden and other extremists. And he looked around at what was a way of educating the kids. And he came up with this idea of the 99. Each of the 99 is a different hero. Each one has a different strength based on one of the 99 values of God in Islam: charity, healing, wisdom. Each one of the 99 comes from a different country. One of them is American. Among the 99, half are male, but half are female. Half of the women, the female superheroes, wear modern dress. They look like Wonder Woman. And half wear hijab, the scarf, the symbol of modesty among observant females. Again, the idea of diversity, the idea of creating good models from Islam. The third trend is the new Muslim theater that is trying to reclaim the idea of jihad from extremists. The playwrights, the documentarians, the filmmakers, who are actually putting the word jihad in the titles of their plays and documentaries. One of them is called, and you're an audience that will appreciate this more than most, Jihad Jones and the Kalashnikov Babes. And it's a comedy, a raucous comedy, about stereotypes of Muslims as extremists. It's written by an Egyptian playwright, and it's been performed in Cairo as well as Dallas and Seattle, St. Louis, and a host of other cities. Again, trying to take a different message and say that jihad is really just about being a good Muslim, which is what jihad originally meant. Another one of my favorite plays is called Till Jihad Do Us Part, a play on the marital vow. And it, believe it or not, is a romantic comedy that's about the challenges of being a good spouse or partner. And the third one is a documentary, and it's a very moving story called A Jihad for Love. And it is a series of interviews done underground with young men and women in countries with the most brutal penal codes, many of them based more on cultural traditions than Islam itself, or that's where they originated. Countries like Afghanistan and Pakistan, Iran and Saudi Arabia. And the interviews are haunting because the documentary has looked for people who want to remain loyal to their faith, the practices of their faith, not turn their back on them, but who are also gay or lesbian. And again, the idea is, as in all these plays and documentaries, is to redefine the idea of jihad to what it originally was, to take it away. It's arguably the most controversial word in the world today, the most heated word, the most feared word. And the idea is to take it back and give it its good values, its positive values, its non-military and non-militant values. My fourth favorite are the new Muslim comedians. Who would have thought of comedy as a tool for counterterrorism? But one of the most interesting things that's happened, and again, that spans East and West, that spans the Middle East and the United States, are the number of young men and women who have come from many different countries to the United States. They've immigrated and learned stand-up being uniquely or originally, anyway, American. And they've started doing their own comedy skits that are, again, against both extremists and against autocrats, as well as against their common problems with their mothers-in-law. And they've taken stand-up back to the region, and they've had workshops in Riyadh, in Amman, in Cairo, to teach stand-up. And the basic idea of challenging your government, needling them through comedy. One of my favorite comedians is an Iranian-born comic called Maz Jobrani, who now lives in Southern California, but comes from Tehran. And I profile him in my latest book. He's a wonderful character, and one of his jokes illustrates my point. He gets up on stage and he says, you know, one guy can really screw it up for the rest of us. Just look at the guy who tried to bomb the Northwest flight from Amsterdam to Detroit. That Abu Mustafa Bubu, or whatever his name was. You know, this guy must have been crazy. After all, where did he put the bomb? Right. In his underwear. Any normal man, even any terrorist, would know that's crazy. And then he reverts to the accent of the terrorist in his last conversation with his terror masters. I have just one last question for you. You say my reward in heaven is going to be 72 virgins. So do you think maybe we can put the bomb someplace else? I mean, I really think I'm going to need my penis. Who would have thought? Comedy as a tool of counterterrorism. The interesting thing to see is the impact across the region. Today in Egypt, Bassem Youssef is a cardiologist with a funny bone who is today known as the John Stewart of Egypt. He has a mock news program with mock news reporters, and he made as much fun of Hosni Mubarak as he does today of the Muslim Brotherhood, again giving voice to challenges, to questioning, encouraging others to act or think or make fun in a way that never happened even a decade ago. Today, there's even a man who calls himself, and think about this for a minute, the Jerry Seinfeld of Saudi Arabia. There are open mic nights at comedy clubs in nightclubs turned for one night a week, comedy clubs in Cairo. There are private clubs that meet on farms and locations outside the cities of Saudi Arabia. Across the region, comedy is one of the most important turning points in this culture of change. Now, my fifth and last point about the culture of change is arguably the most sensitive, and that's what's happened among the girls. One of the most striking things is the fact that when I talk about the majority of the young are literate, that for the first time includes females. In Saudi Arabia and Iran, the two most repressive societies in the Middle East, over 60% of the university student body across the country, in both countries, is female. And when you empower and educate over half your population, that changes a lot. And it's an interesting phenomenon. In Iran, before the revolution, many traditional families didn't allow their girls to go to school beyond the sixth grade. But after the revolution, not necessarily because they liked the regime, but because they thought their girls were safe. They were allowed to be covered, which the Shah had not allowed. Their curriculum was more regimented, not a curriculum that any one of us would approve of. But that led girls to become, families to allow their girls to go to school beyond the sixth grade. And since the revolution, Iran has won the UN's highest award for closing the gender gap between males and females. And today, the population in elementary school is six girls for every five boys. And that's really begun to change things. Iran has even had a female vice president. What country is it that hasn't had a female vice president and boasts of its women's rights and democracy? So another of my favorite stories is about a young filmmaker in Iran who heard about two 12-year-old girls, whose father was an illiterate laborer and whose mother was deaf. And the father had never let the twins outside the two-room house. And the neighbors heard about this, eventually figured out what was going on, and told the state. And social workers came in and took the two girls from their parents. And it was on the evening news, the story of these girls who were retarded in the sense, not born retarded, but because they had not been exposed to any education. They'd never been properly bathed because the family didn't have a proper bath in their two-room house. Who'd never seen another child, you know, just very limited in their exposure to the world, didn't have a television. And so this young filmmaker, or aspiring filmmaker, 17 years old, heard about the news and wanted to make a documentary about what happened to the girls, and went to the state, because to make a movie in Iran, you have to get approval for the government, because they're the ones who actually hand out the film to make a movie, and then had to get the permission of the parents, which the state encouraged. And the young filmmaker made an incredible movie, which you can download on Netflix now, called The Apple, a wonderful movie about these two little girls coming out and for the first time playing a game, a version of hopscotch, seeing their first child, a little boy biblically dangling an apple in front of them, their first animal, a goat. Wonderfully moving story. And at one point, the social worker coming back to the house and finding that the father had locked up the girls again because he was so nervous about them being not just exposed to the outside world, but overexposed. And so the social worker took the girls outside and summoned the father inside and then locked him in. So the young filmmaker was entered in the Cannes Film Festival and won the award as the best new director in the world. First film. And the filmmaker was also a girl. And the movie was shown at film festivals all over the world. And in New York, she was asked, what is the state of Iran today? Is it a place where 12-year-old twins are sequestered by their parents, or where a 17-year-old girl can win at Cannes? And she very rightly said, both. A lot of these countries are in transition, but transitions have begun. And in every country of the region, you can see that women have been major players on the front lines of the protests. They've been very active, particularly with the men fighting and organizing societies, often getting out and being the effective breadwinners because the rebels are not making an income. Organizing society, making sure everyone's fed, organizing healthcare, taking care of societies, the kind of mobilization that the men would normally have done. So those are my five kind of culture of change. Now I want to talk to my 10 truths of the region 2 years after the uprisings began. The first is that today over 120 million people have either been empowered or are in the process of struggling to be empowered. That's over one-third of the Arab world's 350 million people. But more people today are also afraid of the new balance of power and the turmoil, the turbulence, the uncertainty that that has produced. 2 years in limbo has taken a terrible toll. The reality is the old order may be gone, but there is no new order yet well established. We all tend to look at elections. What are the outcomes of the first elections, first democratic elections in many of these countries? When the most important thing, as we recognize in our own history, is the writing of a constitution. And that's where many of these societies are in the midst of particular turmoil. Only Egypt has a new constitution, and it's at the center of the contention today because of controversies over what's in it and how quickly it was written and passed. To give you a sense in the Middle East of why this constitution writing is so controversial, I want to take you to Iran, back to Iran as well. I covered the revolution and the early years of turmoil. I've actually been to Iran almost every year since 1973. And the interesting thing was when Khomeini returned to Iran, he went back to the seminary in Qom, where he once taught before he was forced into exile. He said clerics could have no role in government. He turned over power to technocrats. You may remember Abul Hassan Bani Sadr, who was president. But the coalition that had together from many different factions opposed the Shah began to dismember, to fight among themselves about what the new constitution should say. And there were 62 versions of the constitution put forward with over 4,000 amendments. And the friction among groups became so intense that they began going after each other. And in this early period of the revolution, a president, a prime minister, 27 members of parliament, and over 1,000 senior officials, including judges and police chiefs, were assassinated. And Khomeini came back from Qom and said, "This has got to stop." And there were two final versions of the Constitution put forward. Neither, again, called for a role of Islam. Neither of them talked about a role for the clerics. But again, the opposition was so fragmented that he then called for a popular election to elect 12 experts to write a new constitution. Well, the secular opposition all boycotted. And so what was elected? An assembly of experts, all of clerics. And they wrote a constitution that institutionalized a role for the clerics. And so Iran has a parallel constitution that the president is mirrored by a supreme leader. The supreme leader is technically supposed to be one to adjudicate differences, to be the balance, the political balance in the system. Then the parliament is mirrored by a 12-man council of guardians who's supposed to be able to say whether legislation is Islamic. The civil and criminal courts are mirrored by Islamic courts. What's happened is that the traditional institutions, which were crafted based on French and Belgian law, were supposed to be the stronger institution. But what's happened over the past 34 years is that the religious institutions have become ever stronger. Iran's basic turmoil is whether the Islamic Republic of Iran, which is its full name, is first and foremost Islamic or more of a republic. And that kind of discussion, although in a very, very different ways, is also playing out now in Arab countries in transition. What is the role of Islam? How do you enforce that role? Or should you enforce that role? Should that just simply be a set of principles on which to base legislation or general political values? This is really a key issue. So we can't look at elections as the final say. It's really the creation of a new order in constitutions. As we all know, it took us 13 years to get there. It may take a long time in the Arab world. But in the meantime, a Darwinian struggle has begun to play out. It is often mean-spirited and even violent. It's a kind of law of the jungle, the political jungle. And I would not be surprised, because of the growing disillusionment within some of these countries in transition, if voter turnouts don't go down, in part because people don't know who to vote for and they're not sure what they're voting for. So that's my first point. The second is that economically, all the countries now facing transitions are worse off economically than they were before the uprisings began. About a year ago, I went to the same street corner where the young fruit vendor set himself on fire in Tunisia. I went back to talk to all the street vendors who had taken his place and were today selling oranges and lemons and figs and dates on a street corner. And I asked them, "So what do you think a year later?" And they all had the same message. "We have far more freedoms and far fewer jobs." And as I said earlier, the uprisings were launched because of a desire for, whether it was social justice or economic justice, it was not really about voting for a democratic party. It grew in terms of the causes and the message, but that's how it started, and that's what people at the end of the day want. And all of these countries are in real economic trouble. No country can afford continued turmoil, and no regime is exempt in the region, even oil-rich Saudi Arabia. The king has injected $136 billion into the Saudi economy to try to preempt protests and discontent in a country that has somewhere between 27, 29 million people, $136 billion for debt relief and housing, for creation of sports clubs and literary societies to give the young something to do. When the United States injected its stimulus in 2008, it was 8% of the American economy, or the GDP. Saudi Arabia's $136 billion represented 30% of its GDP, and that's something it can't afford indefinitely. The third issue is the proliferation of democracy. There is almost too much. Let me explain. I was in Libya last fall, and shortly after the election in the summer. Libya's new General National Congress has 200 seats. 80 of those seats were delegated for parties. 120 were for individual candidates. For the 80 seats, 130 parties competed. For the 120 individual seats, over 3,000 candidates competed. In a very short election, we've got two parties, and how long do our election seasons go on? Tunisia and Egypt also had over 60 parties competing in the first democratic election. Very few were organized. The bottom line is that this is unmanageable in these new democracies. And it reflects the fact that there is not enough sense of common interest, of common good. It is all about me, 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 and not us, us, us. Democracy is half about empowerment, but the other half has to be responsibility in order to have balance. And the problem is we're not at the stage in any of these countries where there's enough sense of responsibility. The fourth new reality is the new Islamic spectrum. We tend to think of, you know, politics as being divided between the secular and the Islamist parties, when in fact, the Islamist spectrum itself is today huge. It's not just one party. And even within one party, there are lots of different tendencies. It's a whole different thing when parties in opposition are converted into parties that are contesting the system. I went to talk to the Islamic parties that won in Egypt's parliamentary election last year, which has since been dissolved. But it was fascinating. The Muslim Brotherhood won 47% of the seats in parliament. And I had identified four factions within the Muslim Brotherhood. So I went to several of the candidates who'd won, and I said, help me understand, you know, the different trends within the Muslim Brotherhood, where they might be going, and so forth. And I was particularly struck when I went to see the only husband and wife who both were candidates from the Muslim Brotherhood for parliament. And he looked at me and said, laughed, and said, four factions? You've got to be crazy. There are at least 20. And my wife and I think differently on virtually everything. There is diversity even within a single party that to us looks monolithic. Then you also have the new Salafis. If there's one word you walk out of here tonight knowing, it should be Salafi. S-A-L-A-F-I. And these are the new ultra-conservatives. And the interesting thing about them is that the Salaf means ancestor. And they believe, much like Osama bin Laden did, that you needed to build in the 21st century pure Islamic societies based on the first three generations of Islamic rule back in the 7th century. So their goals are, in terms of politics, are very similar to a lot of the extremist movements. Now, the Salafis have traditionally been apolitical. For 14 centuries, they have not been part of the political dialogue. They were willing to embrace Hosni Mubarak in Egypt because at least he was a Muslim. But after the uprising, they began to realize, well, to be part of what's happening, we need to form a party and run. And they did. The Muslim Brotherhood had been trying for 84 years and working gradually to be part of the political system. Under one of Mubarak's last parliaments, they had 88 seats. They were the largest opposition. The Salafis, a year and a half ago, came out of nowhere, having no political organization, and they won 25% of the seats in parliament. Now, they're fractured among themselves, too, not just within countries, but across the region, so that you find that militant Salafi groups were the ones that were responsible for the attacks on the American embassy in Cairo, the American mission in Benghazi, where my good friend Chris Stevens was murdered, and the American embassy in Tunis. But you also find that the majority of Salafis have decided to work within the system. And that's the thing that has changed the most. You may not be happy with the Muslim Brotherhood as the dominant political force in Egypt, but just pray that the Salafis don't do better in the next election, because they are a huge and growing political factor. The fifth new reality is that security is deteriorating in all of these countries in transition. In Libya, there are over 300 militias that were formed in the eight-month uprising against Muammar Gaddafi. A quarter of a million men under arms in a country with 6.5 million people. Now, the government has tried to bring the militias under police or army control, under their command, to turn them into government forces. Some of them are cooperating, some of them aren't. Some of them pretend to be cooperating, but aren't really. You can't put them in neat categories. Libyans today have 4 to 5 guns per head, according to the deputy prime minister, and that includes babies. When you go into the Rixos Hotel, which is the legendary hotel where the journalists were during the uprising, there's a huge sign with a red line through it when you walk in the door, with a gun behind it. No guns allowed. The problem is also that until you get that new constitution, until you figure out what your new political system is, a lot of these militias don't want to give up their arms, because that's their only means of protecting the political interests of their tribe, their clan, their village. And they all want to make sure that they have a little bit more of the pie than the next clan or tribe or village, to make sure that what Muammar Gaddafi used to do, divide and rule, isn't used against them. And of course, you don't have enough of the pie to give everybody a little bit more than the next one. And as a result, insecurity in the one country that has a small enough population and a large enough oil income base to actually make the transition may not make it, at least anytime soon. And the same problem is happening in a number of different countries. In Egypt, there's something called the black bloc thugs, the riffraff misfits, that we're finding armed factions who are not ideological, but they emerge in systems where there isn't enough order, where there aren't police who understand the rule of law and enforce it in the right ways. In Syria today, and think about this as we debate what to do next, there are somewhere between 200 and 2,000 militias. Some of them are very, very small. Some of them have bonded together to try to work. But all of them come, again, from different clans or tribes or neighborhoods or villages or towns. And they have, in the aftermath of the fall of the Assad regime, they will have their own interests they'll want to protect as well. The sixth new reality is that tribes are reemerging as a defining force in the political vacuum. Without a strong state, the old tribal elders are emerging as players. We're all going to have to go back and take a look at who are the tribes and how do they cross borders? What is this structure? And one of the problems is how it's they're being abused. Libya has 130 major clans and tribes, 40 of which are important, and all of them are political players. I was an independent observer during the Jordanian election for parliament in January, and it was striking to me that people in a new democracy, or it's not a new democracy, in a transiting democracy, and I think it's a sham transition, frankly, but that they are often voting on tribal lines. The seventh new reality is the demographics and the downside. You mix that with the combustible economic and political factors, and they're creating a very uncomfortable future. The young want rewards, and they want them as quickly as they ousted old dictators, whether it's healthcare or education or jobs. They want to see something tangible, and there's no government, again, because of sheer economics, that can provide that. And again, no country is exempt, including Saudi Arabia. I told you, the average age is 26 in Saudi Arabia. The average age of the cabinet in Saudi Arabia is 65. The king is anywhere between 89 and 92. His two heir apparents died of illness. The next in line is not all that well. And so there are questions just about not just a generation gap, but a three or four generation gap in a country where among the young in oil-rich Saudi Arabia, unemployment among the young is 39%. Time magazine is doing a piece in the next week about poverty in Saudi Arabia, and it's really quite striking. The eighth new reality is corruption. In Libya, where corruption is now rampant, a cabinet minister said to me, we used to have one Muammar Gaddafi. Today we have 6.5 million. And again, you go back to that, everyone wanting to protect their interests, whether it's for their families or their larger social entity. And corruption is even a problem in the aid going into Syria. The number of, whether it's the tribal mafioso along the border, people wanting to make money, sheer greed, good chunks of the aid going in from the international community is not getting to a lot of the key cities in the north. The ninth trend, and I'm about to finish, is going back to women. That for all the changes among women, they're not faring very well in the transition. It's not uncommon in democratization. In Eastern Europe, women who had been part of the proletariat under communist systems suddenly found that there were no protections. And Romania went from something like 40% female members of parliament down to 3. I mean, the numbers were very striking in several countries. The problem is both political and physical. There is a growing problem with physical security, sexual assault, and rape, particularly in a place like Egypt. And quotas are also disappearing. At least under Hosni Mubarak, women had a quota, I think it was 10% of the seats in parliament, and those quotas are disappearing today. My final new reality is one that is probably the most contentious. But I think we have to rethink about the map of the Middle East and whether the old Sykes-Picot Agreement, crafted by British and French diplomats, that created the modern Arab states, the first change I talked about after the Ottoman Empire collapsed, may well change. I thought after Iraq that it would hold together when there were a lot of alarm calls about it dividing up into Shiite, Sunni, and Kurdish regions. But I'm beginning to rethink that because of what's happening in Syria, that the map may change in ways, whether it's the changing of borders, whether it's decentralization, soft partition, that there are a lot of different ways it could change in lots of different places. For example, not only do you have the Kurds in Syria potentially aligning with the Kurds in Iraq, and even in Turkey now that you have a peace deal, but you have Sunnis, particularly in Iraq, that have tribal overlay with the Sunni tribes in Syria. It's a much more natural alliance, particularly as the Sunnis in Iraq are increasingly disillusioned with the Shiite-dominated government in Baghdad. So again, it's something we need to be open to and not think in terms just of the borders we know. Syria could unravel a lot of things, more than any other development, because it's not only the strategic center, it is also the most fragmented country in terms of ethnic and sectarian differences. Now, I don't want to end on a negative note. I gave you some good news. I've covered change for the last 40 years, and I was in Soweto in South Africa when the Black Mass Uprising began in 1976. And I covered it for several years. Then I went back when Nelson Mandela walked to freedom 15 years later. A generation later again, the average Black is worse off today than he was under apartheid. 20 of the 25 million South Africans live in poverty. The average life expectancy when Mandela walked to freedom was 60 years. Today it's 41. That's tangible. And it has a good bit to do with AIDS, but it has a lot to do with government policy. In the Soviet Union, and I covered the demise of the Soviet Union, a generation later, you still have a former communist and KGB chief in power who could well be there till 2024. So my point is, we expect more of the Middle East than we expect or have seen in other parts of the world during this extraordinary period of change. And my last comment is, for anybody who's seen Lincoln, they know that it took us 60 years to get from the 12th to the 13th Amendment, and only after a very deadly, costly civil war. And then it took us a century again to get to the Voting Rights Act. And today that Voting Rights Act is in front of the Supreme Court and may get partly gutted. Change does not happen in a straight trajectory. It doesn't happen quickly. There are lots of diversions and messy politics along the way. I think we're headed for a very turbulent decade, more turbulent than the last decade. I'm more optimistic long term. I'm an historian by profession, and I think the forces of history have changed in dramatic ways. I think this is the greatest period of turbulence and transition and redefining the world generally since the creation of the nation state 500 years ago that began a series of changes politically. So pessimistic short term, more optimistic long term, in the same way that I'm more optimistic generally about a world that has turbulence elsewhere. And so I'll end there and I'll open it to your questions.
Okay, for those who have been here before, you know I have a few rules on questions. The first one is, please wait for the microphone so everybody can hear your question and so that we can record it properly. The second rule is, we ask you to state your name and your affiliation. No acronyms, please. The third rule is, you only get one question each, and don't violate it.
And one more rule. I want some questions from the girls, too.
And one more rule is, we know everybody likes to put their question in context, but you got to keep that context short, please.
Hi, thank you for your remarks. My name is Avi Panth. I'm in the Navy. And since we are talking about U.S. national security imperatives, how does any of what you said really tie into our national security? And, there seems to be this implicit assumption that cultural alignment will in some way reap national security benefits. Is that something that you believe in, and what gives you confidence in that?
It's a great question. I had a whole thing, and then I looked at my watch and I realized, about the four big challenges we face in that region. And One is Iran, and that may be the most pressing over the next year, year and a half. I doubt anything's going to happen this year, barring, you know, the wild card. Syria, which is really pressing, and I think we're beginning to get to a point, particularly after the president's trip, that there's a sense of mood change, even though I don't think we're likely to provide the big stuff, manpads and stuff, to the rebels. The third is, what do we do about these countries in transition? Because there will be no Marshall Plan to help bail them out. Remember, Europe had the skills. It had the history, the development, and it was a matter of providing them funds. The Middle East needs far more. And that's a really urgent problem because of the danger that states deteriorate into even deeper uncertainty and instability. And the fourth is the Arab-Israeli conflict, the world's longest at 65 years. One of the ironies is that when the Israelis look out at the landscape and all the changes, the Palestinians are among the players they know the best. Who would have thought? And with whom they have a history, a longer history today, of interlocutors, either direct or indirect. So what do we do about it? We need to be creative at a time that there are limited economic resources. When it comes to a place like Egypt, which accounts for one quarter of the Arab world's 350 million people, they need a lot of help. And we can do things, whether it's helping create small and medium-sized enterprises that generate jobs, in providing technology. They're not going to get a lot of foreign investment from the United States, maybe more from Europe, potentially. Not much, given Europe's economic mess. But because of the proximity and immigration concerns in Europe if North Africa doesn't stabilize. There are ways in which, you know, my friend Chris Stevens, who was the ambassador assassinated last year, was working on a plan to get 5,000 Libyans visas to come to the United States for 3 months to get some vocational training, to get some firsthand exposure to what democracy was like. He wanted to get, you know, leaders at different positions, whether it was new civil society or even of some of the militia leaders that were had decided to work with the government, to give them the ability to go back and say to their followers, their, you know, people they worked with, this is what we need to do. This is how we need to organize. This is the idea, to give them the kind of exposure. And unfortunately, that idea died with Chris. You know, there are things that we can do that are smaller scale, that are, you know, as I said, imaginative, that I'm afraid we're not rethinking enough. With Iran, I think look, that's a really long discussion. What do we know and what don't we know? How much of it is by deduction? I've long been suspicious of what Iran wanted to do, but I also know, I covered the 8 years of the Iran-Iraq war. I saw use of chemical weapons against them, verified by the United Nations. I went back in 2002 on the eve, just before we invaded Iraq, because there were a lot of suspicions about what Iraq might use against us. And I was stunned to find, I wanted to know what the Iranians had discovered about, you know, Iraq's chemical weapons and so forth. And I was stunned to find that the number of casualties had doubled from 50,000 to 100,000 that were really deaths because of something called low-dose exposure, which I'd never heard of. And the Iranians discovered by accident because people were still dying in 2002 from a war that ended in 1988 because of low-dose exposure. And I went to the hospitals and I saw the people. I went to hospice care. And if I were an Iranian, given the fact they haven't invaded anybody in 200 years and so forth, five of the nine nuclear powers are on their borders, I'd want a nuclear weapon as a deterrent. They see, you know, Pakistan next door. They feel, as a minority, they're the largest Shiite country, but Shiites are only 15% of the Islamic world. They feel vulnerable. I mean, we think we have a right to fear, and Israel has a right to fear, but the Iranians are motivated by fear, too. I think there is, you know, I'm not sure we can get there because 34 years is a long time. It's taken us longer with the Iranians than it did to heal with the Vietnamese after that war. I think there is a potential, if fear doesn't derail or undermine the process. I think there are other things that can happen, whether it's cyber war, diminishing their capability, sabotaging what they're doing, whether it's on centrifuges or sucking out information from their computers. I think there are a lot of things that can erode that process, maybe buy us some time. I don't think the Iranians want a military confrontation, but I also think that their national pride is unbelievable. I often say to audiences, do you know anybody from Texas? Do you know anybody from Texas who's also a Cowboys fan? Whatever the Texas criteria, they're the most chauvinistic people we have in the United States. Add 5,000 years and you begin to understand Persian nationalism. And that's a big factor. They don't want the outside world dictating to them. If any of you, just one last little point. If any of you have a chance to go to the Sackler Gallery and take a look at the Cyrus Cylinder. The Cyrus Cylinder comes from the Persian Empire. The Persian Empire was the first empire in the world that crossed ethnicities and religions and land infrastructures and road systems and waterways, and it stretched from China to Europe. And Cyrus was the emperor who freed the Jews of Babylon. And people kind of think that's where it ended. In fact, the Cyrus Cylinder, which has been housed at the British Museum and is now on display here, was really about tolerance of other cultures and languages and ethnicities and religions. And the Cyrus Cylinder, this little tiny rugby-sized with tiny little chisels telling the story, is really about tolerance. And Thomas Jefferson, in telling his grandson how to understand an aspiring democracy, told him to begin by looking at Cyrus. And Harry Truman, when the United States backed Israel's creation after World War II, was told by the chief rabbi, you are our Cyrus. Cyrus is something that most Americans don't know about. But Iranians think of themselves as inheritors of that great legacy. And that doesn't mean that their leaders are good guys, because trust me, I know I've interviewed the last four presidents, including Ahmadinejad, four times. And he says, well, this is going on video, right? Iran is not as simple or straightforward as it sometimes seems when covered by my colleagues in the media.
Oh, I'm Jeff McCausland, Strategic Studies Institute, U.S. Army War College. A footnote, and the question footnote is, in terms of change in your comment about Lincoln, please remember that the state of Mississippi only ratified the 13th Amendment this past February. So it takes even longer than you ever imagined.
I didn't know that.
That's true. That is, in fact, true.
This year?
Yes, ma'am. Does take longer than you think. My question is about, I'm going to press you on Syria. And I want you to basically evaluate the policy. More voices now about intervention. It appears, however, as the rebels, if you want to call them that, as they're more successful on the battlefield, they tend to more disintegrate politically. And we've seen the recent resignation of some of their leaders. And so this is a more fragmented, they're more successful militarily, but more fragmented politically, which makes it very difficult to support. And another part of that is, many people characterize that particular conflict now as a surrogate war. Shiites, Iranians, somewhat Iraqis are good friends, supporting the Alawites, which is, you know, a Shiite sect, versus the Sunni population supported by the Saudis and the Qataris. And I'd like to know how you felt about that. Thank you.
Yeah, another complicated place. Look, one of the basic problems is we don't want to make the mistakes in Syria that we did in Iraq. And my concern is that I want to take the political and military separately. The political, the Syrian National Council originally and now the coalition, which includes the council as well as some others, kind of makes me nervous that it looks like the Iraqi National Congress. And I knew Ahmad Chalabi for 30 years. And this is a guy who left at the age of 18 in 1958, and he snookered us. I think that there are some Syrians and exiles who are part of that political community who are very genuine, but I don't know how much they represent what's happening inside the country. And for 2 years, unlike Iraq, you've had an opposition that has begun to not only take territory, but actually administer it. And I recommend highly a piece that Time magazine put on its website yesterday or the day before about how Islamists are ruling the city of Raqqa, R-A-Q-Q-A. It's very insightful, and this is where Islamists have taken over. So there are also revolutionary councils that have emerged inside that are not just Islamists. Some of them are, but some of them aren't, that are local. There are local coordinating committees, that there is a local infrastructure, nascent civil society, that has far greater legitimacy than the Syrian National Coalition, which, as you noted, is in terrible disarray. You have a chairman or a leader who has resigned, and a new prime minister from Texas who was rejected by the Free Syrian Army. And this is, again, they are saying, wait a minute, you exiles are taking over things that we have done. You want the rewards, the credit, the political power and perks and so forth. And there is a questioning, particularly because of the Iraq model. They live next door. They know what happened. And so anyway, so you have this group supported now by the United States and 100 other parties. Then you have the Syrian Free Army. Now, the Syrian Free Army, again, is a lot of different militias that may loosely be coordinated, but they really aren't taking orders from the military chief, who unfortunately was bombed yesterday and had his leg amputated. And he's now in Turkey. So I am haunted by Afghanistan and the fact that we blindly provided weapons that the Saudis paid for the Mujahideen. That war ended in 1989, and we are still buying parts of Stingers back. I know there are arguments about, well, you can create a shorter shelf life for Stingers and so forth, but what happens to them? I mean, what prevents them from being sold from one militia to another and so forth? You've got Israel in the neighborhood. Suddenly, you know, that conflict takes on a different dynamic, the potential for arming the Syrians. I'm very nervous about the U.S. arming them. But I also think the U.S. isn't doing enough. I mean, we recently gave $60 million for humanitarian aid. We've given $155 million. Sounds like a lot. But you've got now 1 million refugees at least. 460,000 in Jordan. I think the total is probably close to 1.5 million refugees. It's 10%, almost 10% of Jordan's population now, Syrian refugees. And then you still have Iraqis left over, and the Palestinians were the majority of the population. You know, you're talking about a country of refugees that we have to be nervous about Jordan, really. And then you have at least 2 million, and some people say 4 million, who are displaced inside the country. There was a piece on the front page of the New York Times yesterday about people living in pre-Roman caves, or Roman-era caves. And then you have half the population living in poverty or need of supplemental, of basic foodstuffs and so forth. This is a humanitarian catastrophe. And the idea of giving millions of dollars, especially because so much of the aid is being ripped off, something more has to be done. And I think we're getting to that point. But I think we also need to have a very serious rethinking of the process and remembering of what's happened to us elsewhere so that we're very careful and don't make those mistakes again. No girls?
Thank you. My name is Stefan Leder. I'm a retired intelligence analyst. In most of the world, the common response to the kind of chaos and fragmentation and lack of civil society that you described is either a military coup or the emergence of a strongman who simply grabs the levers of power and and says, we'll do it this way.
Yeah.
And the Middle East obviously has that tradition over many, many years. Is that the more likely outcome for these nascent democracies, using the word very loosely, than development of a true democratic societies in the short run?
You know, Sam Huntington was controversial for his Clash of Civilizations, but he wrote a very good book about the three waves of democracy. And we may well go through that in the Middle East. I have said to many audiences, beware the example of Venezuela, the first country to become democratic, 1952 in Latin America, that then went on and democratically elected a man who in the 1990s tried to engage in a military coup to oust a democratically elected government. That when people become uncertain about their future and their ability to feed their children or get education or their women to walk out to get, you know, to shop just for basic foodstuffs, people are attracted to strong leadership, to discipline, where the rule of law isn't applied. So I share your concern. And I also have wondered, you know, if Egypt gets much worse, do you see the military going in a la Turkey and its early experience with democracy, where you saw three coups d'etat? And, you know, the mimicking of that decades-long process. So I share your concern. And this is why I think whether, going back to the first question, what do we do and about, you know, that we're awfully miserly when we may end up paying a far greater cost down the road, whether it's failed states or new strongmen who then make it more difficult, whether it's for Israel or our interests or whatever, that we need to be bigger in our thinking about how to help this very volatile transition period. Do you know, every audience I've ever spoken to, I have to say, I want questions from the girls. I do not get it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm a girl. My name is Carol, and I'd like to ask you a question. In the short term, and I know that you know, we take a long historical look at things, and we have to be patient about change. But in the short term, like for example, in the next 4 years of this administration, what kind of recommendations would you make? I mean, you've been there, you've seen it, you know what's going on right now. You've also seen the change that's happening here in our country. So, what would your recommendations be?
Well, I gave a bunch of them when it came to Syria, and then how to try to think creatively with the transitioning democracies. I really hope that we don't engage in a military conflict in Iran. I cannot tell you, it would make Iraq and Afghanistan combined look simple by comparison. We can achieve some of our military objectives. We're very good, by and large, at achieving them. Our problem is on the other side of knowing what's next, knowing how to make it happen. We can't take credit for Europe's success after World War II. We provided the funds, and they the know-how. And we have proven in Iraq and Afghanistan that we don't know how to build nations. It's a tragedy because we are altruistic. We mean to do well. We just don't know how to do it. We don't know enough about their cultures. We're not, you know, we want people who speak English and have read Shakespeare. That's one of the lines I had from an Iranian who said, you don't know how to deal with anybody but those who mimic you, who ape you, you know, that you can't think outside. And I don't think that we know what we want in Iran next. We don't want them to have a nuclear weapon, but what do we want politically? Have we made the decision, even though we say we honor the Islamic Republic, its constitution, its leadership? Is there really a secret agenda there? Or do we suddenly find ourselves having to come up with a, you know, an aftermath plan, day after plan? I also think that you can't bomb knowledge. And we could, through military action, maybe defer what we think they're doing. And I want to be clear, I don't know what they're doing, and I want to be devil's advocate given our experience in Iraq. I understand why they'd want it, but I'm not going to go there and say they have it or they're doing it because I don't know that. And they really do need nuclear energy because their population has reached the point that they'll run out of oil to export by 2025, according to current reserves. So we could maybe hit, whether it's Fordo or Natanz or whatever, and delay a program. But in the process, then rally that Texan-Persian nationalism to the point that they would back the regime when we know the tens of millions of people who got out on the streets in 2009 are not happy with the political system, and make sure that they have the same rallying around the flag that they did in 1980 when Saddam invaded, when the revolution was running out of steam. And I know because I was there. And it was the most beneficial thing that happened to the clerics, was that Persian nationalism being revived. And at that point, then Iranians, who do want better relations with the United States, one of the few countries in the Islamic world I go to that they love Americans, believe it or not. Really. I mean, they like our movies. It's not just culture. I mean, they know our political players. They can debate politics in the way that, you know, with the sophistication that a lot of Americans can't. And to have them rally around the flag and the leadership would not be what we're looking for long term, and that's a moderation.
I'm Robbie Harris, a former naval person, and I would wear a skirt if you thought that would help.
No, I just want to encourage women, you know. Somebody encouraged me a long time ago.
I thank you very much for your very thoughtful comments tonight. It seems to me, at least in my mind, I could divide your comments into a good news, bad news side. The good news side is, you know, the 100 or 99 comic books, the Islamic comics, the number of satellite TV channels and what have you. And the good news side, it seems to me, is completely divorced or separate or independent from the bad news side, which are the 10 realities you talk about. And given those 10 realities you talk about and your comments just a few minutes ago about how poorly we do at nation rebuilding, why should it not be the policy of the United States that we would double down on Israel, Turkey, Egypt, and Saudi Arabia and let the rest just play out as it might?
Oh, that it were that simple. Look, the Arab-Israeli conflict should have been solved a long time ago. We know the basics. There's no other conflict in the world which the outlines are known by everyone, whether it's a two-state solution, that Palestinians are not going to get right of return, you know, they'll get a little bit of Jerusalem, but less than they think or want. But, you know, all these things, we know where it is. It takes political will to get there. You begin to solve that, and then you solve other things. So that is, I wish we were doing more. And a president in a second term normally can do more in foreign policy and has to, particularly in the last 2 years, because he's a lame duck and, you know, it's the one area that he can devote more time to. I've covered presidents dating back to Jimmy Carter and secretaries of state dating back to Kissinger. And, you know, it's a frequent pattern. The most tangible, important development out of Obama's trip was Turkey and Israel. That is not just good for cooperation in Syria. It changes the atmospherics. Turkey today is the most powerful country in the Muslim world. It's the world's 16th or 18th largest economy, depending on your numbers, and within a decade could be one of the eight largest countries. And the leverage that the model that Turkey is dealing with Israel then prods other Islamist-led governments, you know, in a different direction than they might have been when, because of Hamas, because of humanitarian aid being blocked to Gaza and so forth, the Islamic world could say, well, even Turkey, which is a member of NATO, isn't dealing with Israel anymore. You know, that. So the atmospherics change, the diplomatic potential begins to change. So that's a really important development. Saudi Arabia. Man, history is going to look back on us and say, what were you thinking? You know, we all know, most of us in the room, not all of us, but a lot of us are of an age that we remember the U.S. relations with Ferdinand Marcos or in the Philippines, or Mobutu Sese Seko in Zaire, the Duvalier, Papa and Son. So, you know, these are people who we were politically convenient, but were terrible in terms of what we wanted, the kind of values we believe in and the things we wanted for their countries. I think we need to be thinking very seriously about Saudi Arabia. And given the realities in the country, that particularly because, you know, there are something like 60,000 princes now. The original founder of Saudi Arabia had 43 sons and even more daughters. And now we're getting to the point that with the second generation in power, now we're looking toward the third, you're really going to have to almost create a new royal family. Because you can't have, you know, 60,000 princes dividing up power. There's a potential for Saudi Arabia to go through some internal political turmoil. Now, not like it's going to look like Egypt or anything, but Saudi Arabia has some big questions. And to that part of the world, we look like we are supporting democracy across North Africa, into Syria, through the Levant, as far as Yemen. But when it comes to those oil-rich countries, and the hypocrisy as perceived in the region is very profound. I mean, the way they look at us. So when you say double down, I mean, for or, you know, on what grounds with Saudi Arabia? It's a country with the gravest human rights record since the fall of the Taliban. Women can't drive, you know. This is the 21st century, and you may want to engage in gradual change, but I'm also worried about Jordan. This is a country that is sometimes cited as the model, the alternative to Syria. Gradual reform, gradual opening up. But the thing that struck me during the elections was that despite promises of reform, Parliament really has no powers. The king can dismiss the prime minister and dissolve Parliament. And there's been a revolving door of prime ministers. Every time people get out and protest, the king just dismisses the prime minister and puts a new one in office. That as a result, people don't think Parliament can do anything for them. And when they look at the vote, they think of it as the moment they can get something in exchange for their vote. And so the vote is a commodity today, that you can get 10 dinars or 150 dinars, a heater, a blanket, a little futon-like mattress, you know, for the floor. That it's the moment, it's the one little freak moment that you can get something out of it. And I saw some widespread fraud. And people don't care because everyone assumes that's all they're going to get. And so the idea of democracy and what it's supposed to do for people is eroding before you even get to that point. And changing the perception and the rules of society when it finally gets there is all the harder. So, you know, particularly in this information age, things, when we talk about slow, gradual reform, it's not like it was a generation ago. And we have to be a little savvier in a country that we take for granted in terms of stability. I don't think the Hashemites at the moment are in danger of being dethroned, but I think Jordan could face some serious challenges.
What might the role might Turkey play in this area, and especially recently with the Turkish prime minister demanding more than an apology from Netanyahu, who for the people who were killed on the bus?
On the ship.
On the ship.
Prime Minister Netanyahu promised compensation as well. Look, the apology was a beginning. It's not over. There is still a Israeli blockade around Gaza. the Turks you know, the Turks want more, so do the Israelis. You know, we want more from our friends, and our friends want more from us. So, you know, nothing's ever perfect. But it's a beginning, and it's such an important restoration of diplomatic relations. In that region, given the growing power of Turkey, a country, again, we often take for granted, man, this is such an important place right now, that this could really do well, not only on Syria, but on Iran. And Lebanon. I think the Turks are probably in the middle of this crisis over Syria's bailout and Greece's bailout, be laughing all the way to the bank, because if they were a member of the European Union, they'd be bailing out their former rivals. And today, you know, their growth rate is astronomical, and Erdogan has been very savvy economically, which has reaped enormous political gains for him. And when it comes to reconstruction in the region, Turkey can play a very important part in Libya, in the creating of where it had a lot of commerce even under Gaddafi, and can play a very important role in creating the jobs that need to employ the militias to get them to turn in their arms and have a sense that they have an alternative job, which they don't right now, is really important. So Turkey is a huge player.
Chick Feldmayer, I'd like to go back to Jordan for a minute. I have major concerns about Jordan as well. The refugee problem, both Palestinian and Syrian, and then the
and
article.
Iraqi, don't forget the Iraqi refugees. Oh,
and the feeling between Jordanians and Iraqis have never been that really friendly. But what I'm trying to understand is the article in Atlantic in the most recent edition, where the king gave a lot of information about the country and himself and his thoughts in a publication he knew was going to be read all over the world. And I'd just like to get your thoughts on that.
Interesting point. I sometimes wonder about the king's slight naivete. It's a little too Western. In an interview I did with him, and I've done several, he first used the term Shiite Crescent to describe that arc of influence radiating from Tehran through Iraq into the Alawite, a Shiite branch in Syria, and into Lebanon. And his office called me after the interview and said, no, you can't use that phrase. No. I said, it's on the record, you know. Sorry about that. I've got it on my tape recorder. Those were the ground rules. You don't take back things. So it was very interesting to see in that interview him talk about the emergence of a Sunni crescent. And he wasn't talking about Sunnis. He was really talking about Salafis, you know, the jihadi crescent. Or not a jihadi crescent. This is where language gets all kind of stereotyped or shortened. He was talking about kind of, I wrote about it in the New York Times last summer, a Salafi crescent, really, which would challenge him, too. And the Muslim Brotherhood in Jordan is the largest opposition force. And they boycotted the parliamentary elections for a number of different reasons. And the king, I worry, who spent a lot of his life, his education, and much of his youth in the West, is not as connected to his people as his father was. And I was struck by a lot of the language he used in that piece as well. And the palace afterwards said, well, certain things were taken out of context. And I don't, not having seen the full transcript, I don't know what might have been taken out of context. But he does say some things that are sometimes either clumsy or shorthand or might be controversial when read elsewhere in the region.
Hi, I'm Sean Cornelius. Just a quick question. Pakistan is quite not in this Arab Spring directly, but they're a neighbor. And you touched on Pakistan a bit. They're also a complicated country, as like the rest of them. What are your thoughts on just them as a player in this larger picture of the Arab Spring?
Oh, Pakistan's going through its own very different experience. And I don't, even though for some reason, I guess, under the previous administration, the kind of Middle East was expanded to suddenly include South Asia. And it's a very different part of the world, very different experience, longer experience with both democracy and military coups, a war that, or security concerns that include India. And once you start moving on, I mean, then India into China, you might as well include all of Asia. So, look, I think it was Bill Clinton who said it was the most dangerous country in the world because it has a nuclear capability, because of the instability and so forth. I'm not sure I think it's the most dangerous. But I, you know, we all have concerns, the obvious ones. I'm not breaking any new ground talking about not dealing with their extremists. There's a story today that came out that Secretary of State Kerry met with the head of security forces, General Kayani, and had dinner with him in Amman, Jordan, and something that wasn't announced. I don't know whether it was true or not, but I suspect if it's out there, it probably was. But he opted not to go to Pakistan because of sensitivities on the ground. And then it gets into the whole issue of drones and to what degree does our shifting military strategy end up creating a different kind of backlash. And that's a whole different discussion.
I'm going to call it a night. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.